mean, it's a beautiful view out here. You know that? It's a fantastic view out here. You can't beat that. You know that? That's nice shot. Okay, boys, how are we? How my bird? How my chicken? How are you, boy? I got a visitor for you, guys. You love this, huh? Come on in. Okay, how are you, boy? You good chicken, huh? You nice chicken. I love you. I don't care what they say about you. Come here. I've been here 5 years.
What?
5 years. I've taken care of the chickens here about for the past 4 years exclusively. Yeah. In all these other shelters, all you get is a bed at a dorm. You don't get a room. In the places where you do get a room, the other places you have to pay.
Oh, you do.
You know that you have to pay. You know, this is the only place around where you're going to get a room and not have to pay. Mm-hmm. I want a little hen. I want my little girl. Come on. You little girl, you. What's the matter with you, huh? Come on. You need to cooperate, little girl, huh? Come on.
Unity Acres, the property that we occupy, was initially purchased by Oswego County for the purpose of establishing on this property a tuberculosis sanatorium. And it operated as such for probably in the vicinity of between 40 and 60 years. With the introduction of some of the antibiotic drugs for the treatment of tuberculosis, the need for inpatient treatment of that disease came to an end gradually. The person who eventually founded Unity Acres was Father Raymond McVeigh, and I guess things just kind of came together as his remembrance that this property was empty and vacant and available, and then the push went on to raise some funds to purchase the place.
We don't call ourselves a shelter. We call ourselves a home for otherwise homeless men. You know, Father McVeigh wanted it as a community or a home, and that's why we don't, you know, there's no set time to go to bed. The men really can come and go as they want.
At any moment, currently, we're usually ranging just a bit above or a bit under 70 men.
They get their own rooms and they have their own jobs to do here. It's not like we kick them out during the day and tell them to go hang out on the street somewhere and come back for lunchtime or something. They live here. They stay here all the time.
TV room, I have a refrigerator, microwave, sit down here, I'm in your way. Get transferred out and the linen's off.
This is the dorm.
When you first come in.
And then after 2 weeks you can get a room.
And they set you up for a room. So he can tell you more about it.
This building is known as the Annex and houses a substantial amount of, there's gotta be close to, I don't know, like 30 residents here. The Annex, and that wing is known as the infirmary because it used to be the actual infirmary and this was the TB sanatorium. This is my room, and I apologize. I didn't realize we were going to be stopping by this way. This is pretty representative of what most of the rooms look like. That's my workstation. I do a little painting and right on the computer, there's closet space back there. And you know, it looks kind of just thrown together and dingy, but we do the best with what we have here.
I pretty much stay in my room and find things to do. You know, I can read, I can watch movies, I listen to music in the day usually, and I have all kinds of sports books and reference books, and I like doing stats, you know. And if I want to visit somebody, I can go out and walk around, talk to a couple people, I'm not like a social butterfly around here. I just mind my own business and do my jobs and do my own thing, you know.
We need more places like this. We need more. How it's going to come about, I don't know. You can probably do a lot to it.
Because it's all about money.
Well, that's true too. So.
It's all about money, those rehabs. I see them. I'm not homeless, well, I am now, but I'm just saying from my perspective of being on, when you get fucked up or screwed up on drugs, you got to go to those rehabs. That's the only thing that's out there. I never knew about something like this.
All the reputation I got from, you know, I talked to these guys that were in the VA hospital, and you got no place to go in the day. You got to get out of there. Then you go there at night, and there's thieving going on. They sell drugs right on the street, you know, this and that, and it didn't seem like it was a very good bargain to me.
I've been to the rescue mission many times. I went to the Oxford Inn a few times. I have gratitude for a roof over my head, but as far as compared to this, there's no comparison. You know, I mean, in the morning, you gotta get up, rain or snow, sleet or hail, you gotta get up, leave at 7 a.m. Wherever you go, you're out there, you know what I'm saying? And then there's a sense of vegetation there, a sense of hopelessness where you can get stuck in that rut. You know, I've seen guys in the shelter systems for years, you know, that just, I mean, I've seen guys that get monthly checks that they drinking drugs, King of the Hill for a couple days. Other 28 days they're in the shelter waiting to do the whole thing over and over, over a period of years, you know what I'm saying? So,
like I said, 3 years ago or back, I was in a rehab, and that was for 28 days. I got out, I stayed clean for about 9 months, and then I got right back into the stuff. It's like he said, you gotta want it.
You gotta want it.
If you don't want it, you ain't gonna do it. But my little boy's changing that for me. Yeah. Thank God. I can't give him up.
Most of the guys who are here were homeless before coming here, very frequently, but not universally. There's some history of alcohol or substance abuse.
13, 14, start experimenting with weed, and let me try that, let me try this. And for years, I was content with it, but I didn't realize that it was progressing. My alcoholism and my addiction was progressing. So I went from weed, I started popping speed, and maybe sniff a little glue, or, you know, just do something to try to get high, you know, to get outside of myself or whatever. And in the mid-80s, I tried crack, and I was instantly hooked.
So there's this guy out in East Syracuse that I used to go to see once in a while to get a little coke, you know. And I went to work for him, running errands for him, and then he says, hey, on the way home, can you drop off a package for me? All right, then before you know it, hey, you wanna make a couple of deliveries, you know. So before you know it, I'm doing everything and delivering packages. So I did that for about 2.5 years, and we got caught, because this one guy got busted in a bar, became a rat, and he had a narc with him, and we made sales, and me and the guy I worked for and the guy we got it from all went down.
I bought a bag full of beer bottles, then I slipped horizontally. Do you know I conformed my body to protect the bottles in midair? Fell on my elbow. Oh my God, that ice. I said, man, you need to quit, man. You fucking sacrificing your body for beer? Yeah, damn.
The true addict that's been through the mill and it has tried all that's offered out there, inevitably they'll end up at bottom without resources, without family, without friends, without help of any kind.
I just kind of left my job and just kind of roamed around my brothers and sisters. I got a, you know, dysfunctional family, and they're into drugs and all that shit, and I just kind of hung around with them for 3 months, went from one to the other, and things just got worse in my life, and I didn't know what to do, so I went to the VA hospital, and they said I had major depression and hypertension, which I didn't even know, you know. And so I was there for 9 days, and they, you know, talked to me and gave me medication and whole physical and everything, checked everything, you know. And they said I had a choice as a short-term place to stay. I could either go to the rescue mission, which I didn't want to go to because I heard stories about it, or I could go to Unity Acres out here in Orwell, Pulaski, whatever. So I said I'll go out there because I grew up in the country, so.
But spring is supposed to be soon, I guess. What is today's date? It's the 28th of March. And we've just about run out of firewood.
The spirit. spirit of Syracuse, the spirit of my neighborhood, the spirit of the inner city, had and around, you know, the surrounding area, it seemed like it had got colder. It had changed, you know, and I love nature. You know, I always loved animals. I should have been a zoologist because I study, you know, animals, insects to elephants, you know what I'm saying? And up here, you know, it's just, I love the nature. I love this peace and quiet. Get up 5 in the morning, walk down to the stream, da da da. You know what I'm saying? Just sit next to the brook and just hear it, you know, meditate and whatever, man. And then you just look at, I go out and I say, man, look at my backyard, wow. You know?
Like it's running underneath it like that? Mm-hmm. It never does that, it's always. Yeah. Yeah. It's peaceful, man. You know, when you're from the city and you hear the sirens and all the bullshit, man, you get, you know, you get a sense of gratitude out here, man.
I don't know how the funding goes. Us in Social Security, we give them, you know, the money for it because you get all the things to eat through here, housing and everything. Where can you get that for cheaper?
Right.
The thing, a place to get away from it all. Get away from them damn shelters and get off them streets. It's too bad that they couldn't build new places somewhere around or get funding for it.
Finances are a little bit tight right now. Because of the fuel and how much it costs to, you know, to heat the buildings, the oil and stuff like that, and the gas. So food prices are up. So of course, you know, it puts a crunch on us, you know, because we're just totally, you know, nonprofit and donations. So that's a little bit tight right now, a little hard, but I think that'll get better.
We do depend on donations to keep our place financially. But with the faith that Father has inspired, and with the generosity of people, when we seem to reach rock bottom, and we don't know where this huge bill, where the payment is going to come from, somebody always comes through for us.
We're really different from other shelters in the way that this is really a place for men to live and call their home. And feel that they belong. It's not just a matter of, as the gospel tells us, to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, and help the poor. We also love them unconditionally.
But I don't think you can beat this anywhere, you know, as far as the help's concerned and what it's set up for the men that are here, all different ages. It's a good start.
It's really remarkable how much the degree of harmony that exists amongst the men most of the time.
But it's just things that I know within myself that I can improve on, you know, that I want to be a better person at, you know. I don't want to go out like that. I want to go out, you know, I want to leave not a legacy, but I want to leave, you know, something that I can say that I help people, you know what I'm saying? That I help people overcome certain things or the things that I went through that they might be able to avoid.
We really try to all relate to each other in a way that a family would relate, and in a loving way.
Other countries I went to too, I mean, they've seen people washing their clothes in the brook, you know, by hand. I just saw how some people had to live and it made me happy to be back here, yeah.
If for any reason anyone has ever found themselves, you know, without a home, you know, a man without a country, whatever that experience, you know, there's a certain feeling that leaves a person with, and we all understand each other on that level.
Looking for something I've never seen, alone and I'm in between. The place that I'm from and the place that I'm in, a city I've never been. But I found a friend, or should I say a foe, said there's a few things you should know. We don't want you to see, we come and we go, here today, gone tomorrow.